बहुत धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ और आज के इस क्लास में आपका स्वागत करना चाहता हूँ। दोस्तों, कल हमारा ऑर्गेनाइजेशन मीटिंग हुआ था। जैसा कि आप लोगों ने ये सोच रखा था कि जेल से बाहर आएंगे तो बाकी जो दो साथी हैं उनके लिए भी संघर्ष को तेज किया जाएगा और तेज किया जाएगा, इसको हम लोगों ने तय किया है। और सरकार की जो ये कोशिश है, धर्म के नाम पे तो चुनाव जीते हैं, इस बार राष्ट्रवाद के नाम पे चुनाव जीतेंगे और अपनी गद्दारी को भुलाकर देशभक्ति का नया परिभाषा करेंगे, ऐसा वो चाहते हैं। लेकिन देशभक्ति वही है जो संविधान में लिखा हुआ है। तो उसी बातचीत के दौरान कुछ साथियों ने कहा कि क्यों नेशनलिज्म का क्लास चलाया जा रहा है। हमने कहा कि ये नेशनलिज्म का क्लास हमारे लिए कम, उनके लिए ज़्यादा है। हम उनको बताना चाहते हैं कि नेशनलिज्म वो नहीं है जो तुम कहते हो, नेशनलिज्म वो है जो हम समझते हैं, और ये क्लास उनके लिए ज़्यादा, हमारे लिए कम है। तो बस दो सूचना देते हुए, दोनों स्पीकर आज हमारे बीच आ चुके हैं, नाम बस कहने की ज़रूरत है, परिचय उनका देना ज़रूरी नहीं है। हमारे, मैं महान कह दूं तो शायद वो कम नहीं होगा या ज़्यादा भी नहीं होगा, दो महान इतिहासकार। और राष्ट्रवाद क्या है उसकी गहरी समझ रखने वाले रोमिला थापर जी, हरिवंश मुखिया जी हमारे बीच मौजूद हैं। मैं चाहता हूं कि जोरदार स्वागत किया जाए उनका, और अपील है कि वो यहां पर डायस पे आएं। और छोटी छोटी दो सूचना है। एक सूचना यह है कि JNU पे आकर के ही मसला रुका नहीं है। जैसा कि मनु स्मृति ईरानी जी की आदत है, हर बार एक नया शिकार ढूंढ लेती हैं। हैदराबाद के बाद हम लोगों को ढूंढ लिया, इस बार टारगेट IIMC और इलाहाबाद यूनिवर्सिटी को किया गया है। बीच में अलीगढ़ को भी टारगेट बनाया था उन्होंने, ये दिल मांगे मोर है उनका। तो मैं समझता हूँ कि पता नहीं अगला नंबर किसका है। इस देश के तमाम यूनिवर्सिटीज़ को, तमाम स्टूडेंट को तैयार रहना पड़ेगा, क्योंकि ये सीधी लड़ाई है। ये लड़ाई देशभक्त बनाम देश गद्दार का नहीं है, ये लड़ाई लोकतंत्र बनाम तानाशाह का है। तो इस लड़ाई में जिसका भी नंबर है वो तैयार रहें, और कारवाया फिक्र जो है ये बढ़ता रहेगा, क्योंकि यह फिक्र इस मुल्क के लिए है। तो एक तो यहाँ से JNU SU की तरफ से हमने बातचीत किया है, हैदराबाद इलाहाबाद सेंट्रल यूनिवर्सिटी की पहली महिला प्रेसिडेंट स्मृति जी कहती हैं कि मैं एक महिला हूँ, इसीलिए मैं यह बात जोर देकर बोल रहा हूँ, पहली महिला प्रेसिडेंट ऋचा सिंह को टारगेट किया जा रहा है। और एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन की तरफ से जो लेटर आया है वो इतना रेग्रेसिव है कि उसमें लिखा गया है, प्लीज 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 मैम आप आ जाइए, आप आ जाइए। उसमें लिखा हुआ है कि कर्फ्यू टाइम पे वो लड़की लड़कों के हॉस्टल में जाती है। इस तरह की बातचीत, इस तरह का मोरल पॉलिसिंग, पता नहीं ये जो लिखने वाले लोग हैं अपने कमरे में, जो महिलाएं रहती हैं उनके घरों में, वो पुरुष जिस कमरे में रहते हैं उसमें जाना इजाज़त करते हैं कि नहीं करते हैं, कभी कभी मुझे इस बात पे भी सवाल खड़ा होता है मेरे मन में। इस लेवल के जो है वो मॉरल पॉलिसिंग करने वाले लोग हैं। तो हमने सॉलिडेरिटी उनको भेजा है, उनसे अपील किया है कि वो यहाँ आए और हम लोग यहाँ पर ज्वाइंट प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस करेंगे और बताएंगे उन तथा कथित देशभक्तों को कि JNU में नारेबाजी और JNU के ऊपर हमला नया नहीं है, पहला और आखिरी नहीं है, यह हमला लगातार जारी है। अगला नंबर इलाहाबाद को बनाया गया है। तो वो आएंगी 2 दिन के बाद उम्मीद है, लेकिन हमने अपना समर्थन भेजा है आप लोगों के बिहाफ पे उनको, जिसका उन्होंने स्वागत किया है, इस बात को कंफर्म किया है कि 15 तारीख का जो मार्च है दिल्ली में उसमें वो लोग ज़रूर शामिल होंगे। दूसरी बात यह है कि कुछ लोग मेरी जुबान चाहते हैं और कुछ लोग मेरा गर्दन चाह रहे हैं, कुछ लोगों को मेरा फेसबुक अकाउंट भी चाहिए, तो हालांकि उस पर बहुत अच्छा अच्छा लिखा हुआ है, इसके लिए उनको बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया, लेकिन शुरू में अच्छा लिख करके हो सकता है कि बहुत बहुत बुरा भी बाद में लिखा जाए उस प्रोफाइल से। तो बस एक सूचना देना चाहता हूँ कि मेरा कोई फेसबुक प्रोफाइल नहीं है, पहले जो था उसको कोई हैक करके डीएक्टिवेट कर दिया, पासवर्ड तमाम चीज़ें पुलिस के पास है, तो मेरा कोई अभी सोशल अकाउंट नहीं है सोशल मीडिया पे। इस तरह के रिक्वेस्ट अगर आप लोगों के पास आ रहा है तो फेक अकाउंट है, कोई चंदा हम नहीं मांग रहे हैं किसी से, कोई ऑनलाइन कैंपेन नहीं चल रहा है, क्योंकि चंदा हम लोग डब्बा में मांगने वाले लोग हैं, ऑनलाइन कभी मांगा नहीं है। तो अगर कोई इस तरह से चंदा वंदा मांगे तो उनको दीजिएगा नहीं, बोलिएगा फ्रीडम स्क्वायर का रास्ता हमको मालूम है, वहाँ जाकर JNVSU को दे देंगे। तो इस तरह की जो अफवाहें हैं उससे हम लोगों को बच के रहने की ज़रूरत है। बस इतना ही बोलकर एक बार फिर से हमारे दोनों स्पीकर का स्वागत करते हुए, आप लोगों का स्वागत करते हुए माइक उनको हैंड ओवर करता हूँ। उससे पहले कि वो अपनी बात रखें, मैं वो अपनी दो बात रखना चाहती हूँ।
मेरी हिंदी बहुत ही कमजोर है, आफ्टर सच एलोक्वेंस आई एम गोइंग टू स्टिक टू हिंदी, सॉरी इंग्लिश। वेलकम अगेन टू दिस टीचिंग। आई वॉन्ट टू से अ फ्यू वर्ड्स अबाउट हाउ दिस टीचिंग हैज गॉन सो फार। दिस इज द 14th इन दिस सीरीज ऑफ टीचिंग्स। For those who are joining us today, this series of teachings is called What the Nation Really Needs to Know, India, the Nation and Nationalism. And it began on February 17th with the talk by Gopal Guru entitled What is the Nation? So this is the 14th such teaching, which has been live streamed, as you all know, and watched worldwide. We had intended actually to bring this teaching to an end perhaps today, but by popular demand it has been extended for a full extra week. We had intended that these reflections on nationalism, which have enriched and complicated the concept, will not only enlighten but will challenge the existing ideas of nationalism among the students and faculty attending and hearing them. We realize that we need a thick, not a thin description, a complex, not a simple history, a robust, not a weak definition of this term. We also realize that we cannot leave it to political scientists or historians alone. And that's why we have invited perspectives from economics, from law, literature, the performative arts, and from science. 2 days ago, Apurvanand made the distinction between worship of the country and love of country, and why the latter is a much more difficult and absorbing task. And I hope that difficulty is what we are taking on in this teaching here today. In these teachings, we are extending the work that teachers do beyond the walls of the classroom, beyond the boundaries of disciplines, beyond the certainties of specific methods. And through this, we are once more demonstrating what the space of the university is and what the space of the university should be. I think we have achieved all this and more. And that is why today's teaching, which should have been the last in this effort, will be the beginning of another week of such reflections. Today, we are fortunate to have with us two former teachers of the JNU Center for Historical Studies, Romila Thapar and Harvans Mukhya, who have seen this place from its early seeding and have jointly participated in many public interventions. And that's why I thought it was appropriate that they talk to us together here today. I have had the good fortune of being taught by both of them as an MA student in the early 1980s. And we were very troublesome students even then. And I welcome them very warmly to this event today. I'm not going to stand on formality and do a formal introduction to them, but I just want to say a few words about the topic, which is the topic of history and nationalism then and now. Happy is the nation without a history. Now, were these wise words actually said by Cesare Beccaria in the 18th century? Even if they were not, they are not only a very important reminder of the impossibility of nationalism without history. As E.J. Hobsbawm reminded us, a nation without a past is a contradiction in terms. Indian nationalism was no exception to this rule of history making and historical myth making. It is a task from which there is no rest, as Nivedita Menon reminded us in the series, because the nation is a daily plebiscite. Who better than Romila Thapar and Harbans Mukhiya can tell us about history and nationalism then and now than these experts from two time periods, early India and medieval India? Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to begin by thanking you, thanking all of you for being here, thanking the people that invited me to come and speak, that's going to be difficult. Anyway, I'll try. I'm laying stress on this because I regard myself, together with a few others, as being what I call the dinosaurs of JNU. We were here at the start. I joined in November 1970. And we were here at the start, and we were here to build a university. And our main concern at that time, we went up and down on this, we brainstormed, we did all kinds of discussions and debates and so on. Our main concerns were two: that it must have a high academic quality so that it will be recognized as a place for students to come and learn in the proper sense. And secondly, that it must be a place where there is free discussion and debate. And over the years, one has been watching, one has been working in JNU, one has been watching JNU, one has been watching the developments. And in the last 1 month or so, I must confess that I was deeply depressed after what happened on the 9th of February, because I thought this is an attempt to break JNU. I feel much, much better now. And I just want to say thank you for being JNU. Now, having said that, done my duty as a dinosaur, let me now come to something much more topical, which is the connection between history and nationalism. This is a connection, which is a very close connection. And it's a particularly close connection because a nationalism has a lot to do with the question of understanding your society and finding your identity as a member of that society. And the question of identity is, in fact, extremely important. I'd forgotten that. Eric Hobsbawm has a rather interesting description of the relationship between history and nationalism. He states that history is to nationalism what the poppy is to the opium addict. What does he mean by that? What he means is that history is one source, and history is also something that gives the nation an identity. And it's these two questions that I'm going to be playing around with this evening. Nationalism emerges as a concept or an idea in modern times as a response to historical changes. It does not exist in pre-modern societies. This I am very, very emphatic about. So we don't look for nationalism in the centuries gone long past. We look for it when society changes to the point where it is required. When it emerged in Europe in the 17th century, it was a time of emerging capitalism, expanding colonialism, the growth of the middle class, and the middle class aspiring to participating in government through democratic representative systems, and has also tried to integrate small territories into larger territories. It brings together many groups, and ideally it encourages a secular identity to ensure inclusive unity. Defined by a new sense of social awareness and identity, there is in nationalism inevitably an inclusive and overarching identity. History is essential to a national ideology, but it has to be a shared history that binds people together. History has to be the bond. It cannot be a history dominated by only one identity, because nationalism does not exist on only one identity. It is all-inclusive. National history, of course, has its moments of joy. It goes to the past, and it has a golden age, a utopian age, which is the exemplar and is very often the kind of society that is held forward as being the ideal society. Not realizing, of course, that whatever society you take as a utopia from the past belongs to the past. It belongs to the history of the past. But what we are dealing with today is the history of the present, which is a rather different history from the history of the past. National identity supersedes existing identities. If it is inclusive, it's generally much healthier. But if it pretends to be exclusive, then it can be quite disastrous. And we've had an example of that, a very severe example of exclusive nationalism in the case of Germany in the 30s, with all this talk about the purity of the Aryan race and the destruction of the Jewish population as a result. But where it has been inclusive, even if scattered, it has had quite a positive effect. For example, the kind of nationalism that we never refer to, but which is very pertinent, I think, to the Indian situation too, African nationalism. Negritude, the way it was developed in the Caribbean by Aimé Césaire and Léopold Senghor, which brought together an African consciousness that stretched from Africa to the Caribbean to North America. It was an inclusive nationalism of a very extraordinary kind, and I think we would do well to study some of that. But let me turn to the Indian situation now. The evolution of nationalist ideas in India was tied to colonialism, and therefore the influence of the colonial interpretation of Indian history is there in all kinds of nationalism to a lesser or a greater degree. In pre-colonial times, there were multiple identities of caste, language, religious sects, and regions. Political ambitions that caused constant wars, kept changing the borders of kingdoms, patterns of caste that differed from the north to the south, from the east to the west, throughout the regions and gave regions a certain kind of identity, and religious identities, which I would like to argue were not based on monolithic religions, but on religious sects. And the religious sect is something to which we should give much more attention when we talk about the history of religion. In sum, we now recognize that diversity was characteristic of India. But we don't stop there. Because if you say diversity is characteristic, then the next question you have to ask is, how did diverse groups negotiate their space and their relationship? And that is terribly important. If you're talking about diversity, you must be aware of this kind of negotiation as well. The colonial reading of Indian history denied this, the diversity. The first modern history of India was, of course, as is well known, by James Mill, 1818, The History of British India, which had two main theses that have had a very important effect. One was periodization. Mill divided Indian history into three periods: the Hindu civilization, the Muslim civilization, and the British period. And this was based on just one feature, the religion of the ruling dynasties, a feature which is really almost incidental to a lot of the historical activities that carried on during the centuries. Nevertheless, that was a feature. History was seen then as the history of two nations, and they talked right through the 19th century. Colonial scholarship talked about the Hindu nation and the Muslim nation. There's some discussion on what the term nation meant then and what it means now, but that apart. And they also said that these two nations were permanently hostile to each other. That was another given as well. And that it had required the intervention of the British to keep these hostilities quiet and to keep these two nations at peace with each other. There were no histories, of course, of India as a unified territory prior to colonial rule. And colonial histories, therefore, tried to tidy up this diversity, not by asking how the diversities related to each other, but simply by projecting large groups of sects and large religions, monolithic religions. They really dramatized the importance of what they called the Hindu religion and the Muslim religion in terms of the confrontation of these two. The interpretation of Indian history then became basic to what came to be called the two-nation theory that has been politically so influential and continues to be influential in some ideologies today. And from this perspective, Hindu-Muslim antagonism became axiomatic to Indian history. The period from AD 1000 onwards was treated largely in terms of discussing this antagonism. This was the basic idea of history. The two-nation theory was strengthened by the idea of majority communities and minority communities, and it divided Indians and encouraged Indians in thinking about their identity as distinct, consolidated, monolithic religious identities. This naturally supported colonial policy as well, and therefore was furthered by colonial scholarship. Nationalist historians writing Philip going on talking about the Arctic Circle, and someone had the bright idea of saying that in those days, in Vedic times, the North Pole actually was located in Bihar. Now, where was the need to project this indigenous descent of the Aryans? It was important if you argue that there was a direct link between them and the Hindus of generation after generation that followed to the present times. It was also interesting that some people, Max Müller on one side, Keshav Chandra Sen on the other side, argued that in fact the British were Aryans, the Indians, upper castes, were Aryans, and therefore they were all part of the same kinship. And they talked about parted cousins coming together. All of this was fine and went on in a very interesting way till, unfortunately, in the 1920s, unfortunately for them, a problem arose, which was the discovery of the Indus Valley civilization, or the Harappa culture as it's called. This was prior to the Aryans and it was not Vedic. Therefore, it was the foundation. And this naturally created a problem to those who believe that, in fact, Vedic Aryanism is the foundation. So that's one reason why today people are busy shifting the dates of the Vedic corpus back to pre-Harappan times. 7,500, I'm told, is the latest date that's being suggested. But the other problem is that the origin of the Harappans and the language that they used is unclear. The language is undeciphered, and we don't know where the Harappans came from. So it's now being argued that the Harappans were also Aryans. So that you get a situation where everybody in the subcontinent from the year zero was Aryan. But anyway, there it goes on. Now, how do these kinds of ideas, how do these ideas and problems connect to the question of nationalism? By the late 19th century, there was an established middle class in India. The colonial economy was tied into British capitalism, and much of the middle class, largely upper caste, had emerged as professionals managing the administration of the colony and its colonial economy. The idea of nationalism began to emerge from this group. So once again, it is a particular historical situation in modern time that leads to the emergence of nationalist ideas. At first, the nationalists requested greater representation in governance, and then gradually, as we all know, it grew into a mass movement, and the mass movement then finally ended up by saying that they demanded an independent nation, which is, of course, the logical outcome of certain types of nationalism. Anti-colonial nationalism then comes to be established, and it endorses the idea of a nation, saying that such a nation had to be a democracy with a secular egalitarian society. The primary identity of this nationalism, anti-colonial nationalism, was Indian. The person, the citizen, was to be called an Indian. It had an overarching inclusive identity that incorporated people of all religions, castes, and languages on an equal basis with equal rights. And this is an important component of what was originally projected as secular, anti-colonial Indian nationalism. This was a new identity, obviously. And in some existing ways, it was seen as a new identity and was projected as that. But given the history that had been written by colonial scholarship and taught to the colonials by the colonizer, the fundamentals of which had not been fully challenged, there inevitably arose two other kinds of what some people call nationalisms and some people prefer to call communalisms, the Hindu and the Muslim. Both these endorsed the old British two-nation theory, and each aimed at establishing two separate nations. Unlike anti-colonial secular nationalism that was inclusive of all, these communal ideologies excluded everybody except those of their own religion. They were not anti-colonial. They were simply hostile to each other. The two initial organizations were the Muslim League and the Hindu Mahasabha, and the Hindu Mahasabha gradually developed and was superseded by the RSS and by various other organizations of that kind, with its ideology which has come to be called Hindutva. This movement has its own history. It took shape from the 1930s, reflecting some influences of Italian fascism. They were very close to Italian fascism. As with all nationalisms of any kind, it turned to history. But interestingly, it appropriated the two dominant colonial theories. the Aryan foundations of Indian civilization and the two-nation theory. These are now described as the indigenous history of India and are said to be the theories that have been cleansed of the cultural pollution of the Indian historians influenced by Western ideas. They are rooted in colonial theories, but that doesn't seem to bother them at all. The core of the ideology is the identity of the Hindu. The Hindu is the one who can claim the territory of British India as the land of his ancestry, Pitribhumi, and the land of his religion, Punyabhumi. Muslims, Christians, Parsis are presumed to have come from outside this territory, and their religion originated in other lands outside. And the territory is, of course, defined by British India. Therefore, because they come from outside and their religion comes from outside, they are foreigners. The Hindu, therefore, is the primary citizen. The true claimants to Indian civilizations can only be Hindus descended from the Aryans. And this is one reason why the Aryans have to be treated as indigenous to India, whether they were or not, because that also makes them the inheritors of the land. There are, however, glitches in this argument, and those of us who have pointed out the problems get our daily dose of abuse on the internet, and we are described as ignorant JNU professors, even if in fact most of us are not of the JNU. But that doesn't matter. The history of the Aryans, as it stands today, on which so much of the ideology of Hindutva hinges, has become extremely complex now because it involves many disciplines. It involves linguistics, archaeology, hydrology, and most recently, genetics. People are going around taking DNA samples and arguing that they're getting samples of the Aryans. The questions we are now asking, we meaning we historians of a different ilk, the questions that we are now asking have moved far, far away from the basic question that they're asking, were the Aryans indigenous or foreign? We argue that cultures don't grow in isolation, so we need to know which other cultures coexisted and contributed to the cultural beginnings of Indian history, and how did this cultural mixture, amalgam, juxtaposition evolve? Those are the questions we are asking. And then we come to the two-nation theory, taking history back to medieval times. This theory has been questioned in various ways by modern historians. And the history of religion, many of us argue, covers a range of religious sects and social groups with a variety of relationships between them. And those relationships resulted in some degrees of conflict or accommodation. But the history of religion has to be seen as that history, not the history of monolithic groups in conflict, confrontation. It is commonly said, and I will only touch on this question marginally, because Professor Mukhya is much, much the more proficient historian to handle these questions. It is commonly said by people that should know better, but obviously don't, that for the last 1,000 years, Hindus have been enslaved and victimized by the Muslims. And now, finally, they are free. That is not what history tells us. In the last 1,000 years, if you look at the status of Hindus in the subcontinent, very interesting ideas, events, people emerge. Sanskrit learning was located at many more centers in the subcontinent than it had been before, because Sanskrit learning spread. and it had a very impressive patronage of maharajas, sultans, and wealthy landowners, many of whom had the money to actually finance patshalas, mutts, and places of learning for Brahmins. There were commentaries in Sanskrit, Quran, digests of law books in many numbers, discussing crucial issues pertinent only to the last 1,000 years. Let me give you an example. One digest has a long discourse on temples are now being built, wealthy temples are now being built, which have access to money, to land, to finance, to investment, and we all know that this was being done by wealthy temples in the last 1,000 years. So the discussion was, who has the higher status among Brahmins, the learned Kshatriya Brahman or the temple ritual priest? Very fundamental question, because it raises the issue of the form of worship and who is legitimizing what form of worship in this multiplicity of sects that are doing their own thing with their own forms of worship. There are striking compositions in this period. For example, the great Sayana, who writes a fascinating commentary on the Rig Veda, which is a very, very interesting insight into the medieval mind and how the medieval mind of the 14th century is looking back 3,000 years on the Rig Veda and giving a commentary verse by verse of the text. Or their philosophy compendia, philosophical schools that are discussed, many, many texts, the most commonly used one being, of course, the Sarvadarshana Sangraha, where the Charvak philosophy constitutes the first chapter. The Charvak philosophy is the philosophy of materialism, discarded in many other more elite philosophical texts, but here it is discussed in full, with the author saying, I don't agree with it. This is not my idea of good philosophy, but because it's being discussed, I am also discussing it in this book, which is interesting. Many texts on mathematics and astronomy are being written, and Indian astronomers and mathematicians, many of whom were Hindu, are praised, discussed, and quoted in texts from Baghdad. Did these mathematicians and astronomers on both sides know Sanskrit and Arabic? Otherwise, how could they have these discussions? How could they be quoting each other? They must have known it. What happened to that tradition? Why isn't it recorded? Why don't we know about that tradition? The shape and form taken by Hinduism, as we recognize it today, draws a lot from these 1,000 years. Bhakti sects become common all over northern India at this time, and the whole bhakti tradition of worship becomes an extremely important part of what we today call Hinduism. The Shakta Shakti worship expands, and the popular sects like the Nathpanthis are developing and growing and expanding everywhere. It's what I sometimes call the Guru Peer religion, because it is the religion of the majority of the people who are going by what is being preached to them by the gurus, the peers, the sants, and the babas. And that is really the religion that we should be looking at. We need to put these facts into a historical context and see them as part of a civilizational and historical process, and not reduce them all the time to the confrontation between Hindus and Muslims. That's a non-starter in Indian history. That should be a non-starter, because we have much more important things to investigate and to discuss. These were religious and cultural forms arising out of the characteristic feature of India at the time, even in the last 1,000 years. It hosted differences. It had an attitude to all kinds of differences. And these differences could either coexist or get amalgamated or create new forms or confront each other. So there was a range of choice in how sects and differences were played out in the society of the time. And once again, we need to see the interactions of the various cultures and explain their mutations and be sensitive to the spaces that they created and observe the emergent identities that came out of them. This can be seen if we don't restrict the study of religion to texts alone, but also explore religions expressed in the oral traditions. Because do keep in mind that the majority, the vast majority of Indians in early times could not read. And the oral tradition was their source of belief and their source of social codes. Religion in pre-modern India, therefore, is for the historian an extremely challenging study, precisely because it is not a collection of monolithic religions confronting each other all the time, as we've been made to believe. It makes far more sense to see religion as it emerges from an array of religious sects that cover the range from the orthodox to the heterodox. And the sects make their own equations with each other, some friendly and some not so. The sect also, the religious sect, is linked to caste. And that has remained common to all religions in India. And let me give you a couple of examples of what I mean by this. Arab traders came in large numbers and settled at the beginning of these 1,000 years, the early centuries, the second millennium AD. They came and settled all down the west coast of India and established their own religious sects, which were a combination, a mixture of Hindu and Muslim ideas and practices and so on. But each of them kept a distinct identity. And despite the fact that some of them had common Islamic elements, they kept their separateness very, very straight because they had correlated with different castes along these settlements. You don't, for example, today get a Gujarati Bohra rushing to marry a Malayali Mapila. And yet their origins are of the same date, the procedures are the same. So the other striking feature is that all formal religions in India, religions of the book, the text, and so on, discriminate against the Dalits, even those that belong to their own religion. Muslims and Christians outside India do not observe this segregation, but in India they do. One cannot study any religion in pre-modern India without investigating its links with caste. Those that were always marginalized, such as the Adivasis and the Dalits and many lower castes, where they were not converted to the formal religions, had their own forms of belief and worship. And these are rarely commented upon in the histories of religion. Sources from early times, and this is my last point, why am I insisting on the religious sect being so important? Sources from early times seldom mention monolithic forms of religion. From Ashoka to Al-Biruni, 1500 years, references to dharma are almost invariably made in the form of references to two streams, Brahman and Shraman. Ashoka has Brahmanam, Shramanam. Megasthenes, visiting India as a Greek visitor, talks about the Brahmanes and the Sarmanes, and so on. The first lot, the Brahmins, believed in the gods, in the divine sanction of the Vedic corpus, and the immortality of the soul. The Shramanas rejected all this, therefore they were called by the Brahmins as Nastikas, non-believers, and later on, of course, they were called Pashandas, frauds. Each of these two dharmas hosted a range of sects, covering variants in belief and worship. Some were accommodating, some were confrontational. There are references, for example, to Shaiva sects being more often than others hostile to the Jains and the Buddhists, which was not unusual because, after all, people had different views. But interestingly, Patanjali, the great grammarian of the early centuries AD, refers to the two dharmas, the Brahmanas and the Shramanas, and he adds that the relationship of the two can be compared to that of the snake and the mongoose. I think that's very telling. I would like to conclude then with a couple of statements based on what I have said. At the time of independence, and soon after, and none of you were born, we had no problems in defining nationalism, and the definition was accepted. Today, efforts are being made to obfuscate it. Nationalism draws on reliable history and not on just anyone's fantasy about the past. Critical inquiry, as we all know, is essential to the advancing of knowledge. It is expected of a university to critically inquire into what may publicly be claimed as knowledge. Nationalism draws on the identity of the citizen. This is preeminent. But it cannot be the identity claimed as superior by any single group. It has to include the equality of all and the equal rights of citizens. Incisive debates on this are part of the nationalist enterprise, which is an ongoing enterprise of the relationship between history and nationalism. And universities are obvious places for such debates. We in India have had a head start with the constitution that we have and with our commitment to making the nation a secular democracy. This has to continue as a hallmark of our nationalism.